morning.
Good morning.
The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? One thing I have desired of the Lord, and that I will never seek after, that I might dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. At this time, let us come before the Lord in prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning with thankful hearts that we are able to assemble in thy house. We ask your blessings on those gathered here today. We ask your blessings on those who are unable to be with us here today. There are many needs throughout the world that only you can help to attend to. Continue to lead and guide us and direct our paths in the way you would have us to go. In the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Okay, let's stand and sing "Oh Worship the Lord." See what all we have going on announcement-wise today. Of course, we've got Sunday school after service today. If you can stay, that would be wonderful. Okay, let me go over a long list of things we got going on. So, we are hosting the district ministers meeting on Monday the 14th. That's at 6 o'clock. We've got the menu going on for that, so that's coming up here. We have our picture day for directory on the 29th. We have met our minimum number of people signed up, so that's good. And we still have more slots that we can put in more people. And if we fill those up, we can still get more people in. So if you have it signed up, you know somebody who wants to get that done, they can either go in themselves or call one of us in the group and we can get you fixed for that. Also planning ahead, on the 27th, the last Sunday of this month, we're going to plan the board meeting immediately after church that day to start and make preparations for council meeting. Council meeting will be on November the 10th, immediately after church service. We still have the sign-up sheet out front for possibly going out to lunch together on the first Sunday in November. So if you didn't sign up for that, go ahead and put your name on so they can get a number of how many we could possibly expect, and they'll work out where to go. Yes?
I met with the manager Friday evening, okay. And he said he would take, we've got some senior citizens and some crutches and things like that, but he said that he would take care of the handicapped people.
Okay.
And if needed, they would have the a police officer down there keeping the traffic sort of.
Okay.
Even. But he did say, come on.
Okay. So planning on having that lunch at Ferrum College. For those who can't walk too far too easily, the manager said they can get their security people to meet people and get them up to the cafeteria, so it's not a long walk or a troublesome thing
and
there.
And we did eat while we were there.
Oh, okay.
It was fried fish, but it was really good.
Okay. Okay, I think that is the list I have. Who has other things for announcements today?
Tommy, we won't have Fresh Aid this week. We will have it the 15th and the 27th.
Crochet is going to meet the 15th and the 22nd.
Next Sunday, barring a bad weather event, or as I always like to say, the rapture, because either is subject to happen, we have a guest speaker. It is my sister in Christ coming from Jamaica. And she was here a couple years back, and Adam has been gracious enough to allow her to have the whole service. So invite your friends and neighbors. I cannot wait for her to be here. It's going to be very different. She's from Jamaica. Her name is Evangelist Lorna Spencer-Smith, and I want you all to be here. Make a point, bring everybody with you, because you are in for a treat.
Okay, so next Sunday, guest speaker from Jamaica. Who else has something to bring up announcement-wise?
Don't forget the shoeboxes.
Ah, yeah. Thank you. Okay. The shoebox program, we've got that going. We're collecting. We have some things. We'll let you know what we've got plenty of and what we might need. Or if you want to take a shoebox specifically for yourself, we can get you that. Also, hurricane offering. The district, of course, is collecting, and so we have put the box out front today that you can put into that this Sunday, and we'll do it again next Sunday, and we will send that into the district for the district to send along their distribution channels of what, and they put out a lot on their website about what's going on with that, if you want to check that out. So hurricane relief offering box is in the vestibule. So remember that today and next Sunday. Okay, that's a lot going on. So nothing else then, let's pause and sing This Is My Father's World.
Oh,
of space. We can see probably 150 up there.
Okay.
So you can bring friends if you want to.
Yeah, so invite other people to come to lunch that day. We can make lots of room there. Okay, we have our list of prayer concerns listed in our bulletin today, if you hadn't had a chance to look that over. And Brenda Shively has broken her hip and is listed to send a card to. And of course, the hurricane damage, weather conditions, and the problems going on in the south there. What else do we have to bring up today?
Tommy, I have a praise and a blessing.
Okay. Okay, Bonnie, good. Good news for Bonnie.
We got a birthday girl in the house today.
Birthday girl. Oh, yes.
We sure do.
Okay. Ready for happy birthday?
Oh, yeah, let me find the music.
Okay. Okay, Maestro, take it away. What else?
Well, Rick Fry, he's got stage 4 pancreatic cancer.
Rick Fry, stage 4 pancreatic cancer.
Byron Perdue, that we put on the list last Sunday, he's had his surgery. He came out of it good, but he's still in the hospital yet.
Okay, Brian Perdue has had his surgery and still in the hospital.
And remember Jerry Harris, he manages the pyramid market. He has 3 different types of stage 4 cancer.
Terry Ferris, who manages Fair Minute Market, has 3 different types of stage 4 cancer.
Thank you for the third
job. Okay.
And Jackie said thank you for the cards and prayer.
Okay, thank you from Jackie for cards and prayer shawl, and also from Sharon Davis for prayer shawl.
I'm an annual scan tomorrow morning, so everybody just remember me.
Okay, Sharon has her annual scan tomorrow morning. Yes, ma'am.
My stepdad
lost the blanket. Frosty's stepdad sends thanks for the blanket.
I'm a
great grandbaby, little girl. Wow. Oh.
I got 2 unspoken requests.
Unspoken requests, others, thank you. Okay. Anybody else? Okay, the choir is not going to sing what's listed in the bulletin, but the choir is going to sing.
Follow the same song, though, right?
Maybe.
I doubt it.
I'm not afraid.
now worship with our tithes and our offerings.
To the house of the Lord, this church that we love so much. I hope y'all had a great week, and I'm happy to see everyone here this morning. It's a beautiful day, and we're gathered as the body of Christ, brothers and sisters in Christ, here to worship Him and give thanks for the great things He's done and all the blessings with which He's favored us. To paraphrase Psalm 63, verses 1 through 4, by simply changing the words I and my to we and our, let me say, you, God, are our God. Earnestly we seek you. We thirst for you. Our whole being longs for you in a dry and parched land where there is no water. We have seen you in the sanctuary and beheld your power and your glory. Because your love is better than life, our lips will glorify you. We will praise you as long as we live, and in your name we lift up our hands. So let's give the Lord the praise, honor, and glory He deserves. Well, Frosty has decided to leave me. We're going to try a little time apart. Nobody should be surprised to hear those words. After all, she's put up with so much. But it's not like it sounds. She'll be here next week, and then she gets to fly to Arkansas and help Catherine with her granddaughter while Brandon travels for work. I told her next time I'll go to Arkansas and help with the baby and she can stand up here and preach in my place. She didn't appreciate that offer. But all joking aside, she will get to go help with the baby for about a week. Then we have a plan coming together to slip away and go to Arkansas for a couple of days over Thanksgiving and have the whole family there, both our daughters and sons and in-laws and boyfriends and all the stuff that come with the family when you have grown kids and our new grandbaby. So we're looking forward to that. You've all seen the news and heard the stories. You know how badly folks in areas hit by Hurricane Helene need your help. I'm grateful that we're collecting a special offering here. The box is in the back. I think it says prayer requests on it, but that is where we'd like you to put any offering that you want to contribute to that. And that'll go directly to the district for them to pass on to the folks that need the help the most. Anything you can give will be helpful. As of this morning, the report I read anyway, 227 deaths have been attributed to the storm itself and the flooding that it caused. And an untold number of other people have lost absolutely everything. Many got out with nothing more than the clothes on their back. The district is also collecting cleanup buckets and hygiene kits. So if you want to purchase a 5-gallon bucket and fill it with cleaning supplies and things to kill mold and all that kind of stuff with, let me know and I can get the link to you. The bucket that they are asking for, if you bought all the supplies with it, it would run you about $75. They're also collecting hygiene kits with toothpaste and toothbrushes and soap and shampoo and other things that people need. And I will get the list out to anybody that wants it or get it put out on the prayer chain or something like that. That's one of the things that the church does in a time like this is we come together to help people in need, and I appreciate what we're going to do for that. If you've ever been part of a big corporation or a large government agency, first let me say I'm sorry you had to go through that, but you may have been had to endure something called a strategic planning meeting. I've been to ones in civilian jobs that lasted all day and ones in the Air Force that lasted 2 days or more. And the main subject of those meetings is typically to set goals for the coming year and milestones that we need to meet in order to achieve those goals. They're usually a day or more of discussion that could easily be knocked out into a couple of hours if people just didn't love to hear themselves talk and love to argue about changing the word puppy to small dog and happy to glad and all that kind of stuff. Those meetings were not totally without value, though. The goals that we set were helpful towards focusing the organization's efforts and helping us get better at whatever it is was the mission of that organization. And big organizations put a lot of emphasis also on their mission and vision statements because they feel it gave the members something to rally around and focus them more on doing a good job. I personally think most people forgot about the mission and vision statement as soon as the meeting was over, because all they wanted to do was get out of the meeting and go home. At least that's how I felt. But that's just years of bitter cynicism showing, to be honest with you. Another very important topic of those meetings, though, was establishing or updating the organization's core values. And this was a slightly more significant discussion for me, if I trusted that the organization was paying the subject more than lip service and intended to conduct themselves according to the core values they agreed on. Core values are supported or supposed to be beliefs that guide the conduct of any organization. I was looking for something on a bookshelf last week, and I saw some of my Air Force memorabilia. And some of the things I went through there had the Air Force's core values on them. Back in 1997, I had been in for about 11 years at that point, the Air Force came up with three core values: integrity first, service before self, and excellence in all we do. So if you're wondering what got me on this subject that probably seems a bit odd to be discussing from the pulpit, there's your explanation. Integrity first means we do the right thing all the time, even when nobody is looking, or because it's far easier to go along with the crowd than it is to do the right thing. We do the right thing even when everybody is looking and thinking that we're crazy for not taking the easy way out. Service before self means we put the mission first. The unit and the people we serve are above our own selves. And excellence in all we do means we strive to do everything with excellence. We don't take shortcuts and we don't slack off, at least in principle. This got me thinking about morals and values in general. And then in turn got me thinking, if someone asked me to sit in a meeting and told me I couldn't leave until we came up with a set of core values for Christians, what would I recommend? Coming up with a long list of them would be easy. The challenge would be narrowing that list down to a few so people wouldn't lose interest. Morals and values are at least a small part of every sermon preached in a Christian church. A person who didn't grow up in the church probably has the idea that our number one goal as Christians is to be good people. To have integrity, be nice to people and not lie, cheat, or steal. To be sure, these are things Christians are known for. That's what we're taught from our first day in Sunday school. Proverbs 11:3 tells us, "The integrity of the upright guides them, but the crookedness of the treacherous destroys them." This verse and so many others make it clear we should be good, moral, honest people. The books of Proverbs and Ecclesiastes were both written by Solomon. And King Solomon, for all of his faults, was blessed with tremendous wisdom. Our Old Testament scripture passage this morning is from Ecclesiastes 3, verses 9 through 13. "What do workers gain from their toil? I have seen the burden God has laid on the human race. He has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in the human heart. Yet no one can fathom what God has done from beginning to end. I know that there is nothing better for people than to be happy and to do good while they live, that each of them may eat and drink and find satisfaction in their toil. This is the gift of God." Depending on the translation of the Bible that you have, many of them will have a paragraph heading above that passage that I just read that says, "The God-given task, our toil and our service to the human race is our God-given task as well as our service to Him." As a Christian, we're expected to live apart from the ways of the world. That's way easier said than done, isn't it? We use the phrase, "be in the world, but not of the world." If you read the account of Jesus praying for his disciples in John 17, verses 14 to 16, it said, Jesus prayed to his heavenly Father, "I have given them your word, and the world has hated them, for they are not of the world any more than I am of the world. My prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, even as I am not of it. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth." We have God's word, and if we put them in practice, those who are of the world tend to get upset by it, maybe even hate us for it. But we are called to be set apart. We accept Christ and walk by faith. When we do that, our faith leads us to set aside worldly ways and seek the path of righteousness. The Apostle Paul had something to say about this in his letter to the church in Colossae. Colossae was an ancient city in what is now southwestern Turkey. It's one of the sites of one of the very first churches. Colossians 3, 5 through 10 is our New Testament scripture passage this morning. And we can see that Paul instructed the members of the congregation there to put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature: sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived. But now you must also rid yourselves of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator. There are many things in that passage that hit close to home for me. I bet many of you feel the same way. Anytime I read scripture warning us about anger, rage, foul language, holding a grudge, being unwilling to forgive, I feel ashamed. That's good. Billy Graham said, "Being aware of your own sin is a sign of spiritual growth." He said, the closer you draw to God, the more convicted of your own sin you're going to feel. All the things I've covered so far are byproducts, I would propose, for core values of Christians. Honesty, morality, purity, and all the others can be called values, to be sure. But in this case, they are the side effects of leading a Christian life. If I had to propose core values for Christians, the first one would be faith, first and always. 2 weeks ago, the title of my message was Faith, Not Sight. I spoke about the debate over whether we're saved by faith and works or faith alone. And I stated my belief was that a solid faith in Christ results in a life that is transformed to do good works on this earth. But it's faith alone that saves us. As the Apostle James said, we show our faith by our works. Paul said we are to walk by faith, not by sight, trusting in God and in His promises. I've preached here many times that it is our faith that secures for us the grace that gives us salvation. It's not our church attendance record. It's not how much money we put in the offering plate. It's not whether you're in the choir, serve on a committee, or as a deacon, or even if you're the pastor. It's certainly not anyone's practice of pointing out the sins of others in order to feel or appear more righteous themselves. True righteousness is important. Remember, though, anyone can act righteous while they're in church. It's easy to be righteous when things are going well. The true test of righteousness comes in how you conduct yourselves the other 6 days and 20-some hours a week when you're not in church, and how firmly you stand in your faith and righteousness when times are hard. But again, righteousness is a byproduct of faith. Faith alone is what saves us. Paul told the young churches in Ephesus, "For it is by grace you have been saved, not through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it's the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works which God prepared in advance for us to do." We are saved by our faith. We earn God's grace through faith. We are blessed based on our faith. All the other wonderful things that come with Christianity are, in their truest form, the result of solid faith in Christ Jesus. If I was tasked to propose core values for Christians, faith, first and always, would be number one. To serve, not be served. That's what I'd offer as a second Christian core value. Mark chapter 10 tells the story of the time two disciples, James and John, his brother John, came to Jesus and asked him, "Grant us to sit, one at your right hand and one at your left, when you come into your glory." In his gospel, Matthew wrote that James and John's mother was the one who came and said, "Please let my son sit at your left and right hand." Whoever asked it, both gospels tell us Jesus said it's not for him to decide whether it's his heavenly Father's decision who gets those seats. But Mark goes into more detail in describing Jesus' response. In Mark 10, 42 through 45, we can read, "And Jesus called them to him and said, 'You know that those who are considered rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. But it shall not be so among you. But whoever would be great among you must be your servant, and whoever would be first among you must be a slave of all. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many.'" The Last Supper, Jesus washed his disciples' feet. Shocked everybody by doing that. But he set the example for us of servant leadership. We, brethren, commemorate this and honor it with our foot washing service as we did a week ago, Saturday. Service isn't only for the military or firefighters or for cops. It comes with being a Christian too. Jesus expects us to help the needy. When he talked about feeding the hungry, giving drink to the thirsty, giving clothing to those in need of it, and visiting the sick and in prison, he said, "Inasmuch as you've done it for the least of these, my brethren, you've done it unto me. And inasmuch as you did not do this for the least of my brethren, you have not done it to me." Our service is not meant to be just to people we know or even people we think are likable. You know the story of the time when Jesus went to Matthew's house shortly after calling Matthew to be his disciple. I've told it here before. Matthew, before he became a disciple, was a tax collector. There were a few groups of people in Israel few groups of Jews anyway in Israel, more hated than tax collectors because they worked for the Romans. They betrayed their own countrymen and helped the Romans oppress them by collecting their taxes, and were all thought to be crooks who charged the citizens more than they owed so they could line their own pockets and get rich themselves. Jesus went to Matthew's house for dinner. Matthew 9, 10 through 13 tells the story. While Jesus was having dinner at Matthew's house, many tax collectors and sinners came and ate with him and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they asked his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" On hearing this, Jesus said, "It's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. But go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. For I have come not to call the righteous, but sinners." The statement, "I desire mercy, not sacrifice," is from Hosea. From early days, the Jewish religious leaders focused on strict compliance with every letter of the law God gave Moses. That was their view of righteousness. They cared more about the religion than they actually did about God and his people. They cared more about all the kosher laws and the laws for the Sabbath than they did about people. All that became especially pronounced with the rise of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. But it started centuries earlier than those folks came around. Somewhere around 700 years before Jesus came to earth, God addressed this and the wickedness of the communities in Judah, speaking through his prophet Hosea, with words we can read in Hosea 6, verses 4 through 6. "What can I do with you, Ephraim? What can I do with you, Judah? Your love is like the morning mist, like the early dew that disappears. Therefore, I cut you in pieces with my prophets. I killed you with the words of my mouth. Then my judgments go forth like the sun. For I desire mercy, not sacrifice, and acknowledgement of God rather than burnt offerings." All the religious practices and traditions are far less meaningful to the Lord and to us, I think, than true worship and glorifying God and serving one another. Burnt sacrifices and other religious practices meant less to God than mercy and true worship of him. During his earthly ministry, the Pharisees wanted to punish Jesus for healing people who were suffering badly because he sometimes did it on the Sabbath, and work's not allowed on the Sabbath. But God wants mercy, not sacrifice, and is more concerned with the spirit of the law than over-enforcement of the smallest detail. We are meant to serve each other. We're meant to help the sick, feed the hungry, take care of the poor. Not just people we like or who fit our definition of worthy, but all God's children, even those who don't know the Lord. Charity is one of the roles of the church and of Christians. One of the ways we can serve is to witness and tell others about the love of God and the salvation found in his son Jesus. Not everyone is capable of doing that, and it's uncomfortable for most of us. But live your life in a way that reflects the love of God and treat other people the way Jesus taught us. And sooner or later, someone will comment on that, and you'll have the opening you need to tell them about Jesus. The third core value on my list is love one another. That one was an easy choice because it's the last command Jesus gave his disciples and us before he went to the cross. This was the subject of the very first sermon I preached here and the very first sermon I preached anywhere for that matter. Love one another. John 13, 34 through 35 says, "A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, you must love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples, if you have love one for another." Jesus gave this command at the Last Supper, just after Judas had got up and left the room to go carry out his betrayal. I'm kind of familiar with commands and orders, something I know a little bit about. I've given many orders and received many more commands. As commands go, this is a simple one. It's a great one. It's simple and to the point. It's neither complicated nor vague. It's specific and direct. It's impossible to misunderstand and difficult to misinterpret. I wonder why, though, why then it's such a difficult command to carry out. Even he tells us this is how people are going to know you're my disciples, if you love one another. Maybe it's just human nature. I know a lot of people of the Jewish faith. I know a good number of Muslims, and I know people from many different Christian denominations. Many of them from all the religions take on a sense of superiority based on their faith, and they look down their noses at people who they view as less righteous than themselves, and they certainly think they're better than someone from another denomination. Oh my Lord, someone from another religion. Then you got the folks who aren't the same color as us, or they have a different lifestyle, or they favor a different political party than the one we vote for. Can't love those folks. And look at that guy. He's a homeless bum. Dude reeks of booze. He probably hasn't taken a shower in weeks. You want me to love that guy? And that guy over there, he's been in jail for terrible crimes, and he mocks God to this day. You can't expect me to love him. Actually, that's exactly what God expects, and it's precisely what Jesus taught us to do in the way he lived his life on earth. None of those things matter. We're told to love one another, period. Have compassion for others. Help those in need. Comfort those who mourn. Love one another is meant to be the defining characteristic of Christianity. Remember the words Paul wrote in his first letter to the Corinthian church. 1 Corinthians 13:13 says, "And now these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest is love." There are many other values and qualities essential to being a Christian: forgiveness, obedience, mercy, righteousness. These and so many more are very important. But I feel all of them could be rolled up with one of the three values that I just mentioned, included in part of one of them I listed earlier. And I'm not actually proposing we adopt a set of core values for Christianity or even for our church. The values we are meant to follow are spelled out in God's Word, the Holy Bible. I found myself thinking about core values for a reason, unrelated to this sermon. As I said, I was looking through Air Force memorabilia. My BMI class ring says, "Honor above self." I described the Air Force integrities, our core values: integrity first, service before self, and excellence in all we do. We call phrases like this words to live by. Words can be very powerful. None more powerful than the Word of God. The first five verses of the Gospel of John say, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. That light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it." Our Heavenly Father sent his Son to this world to bring the Word to life. Paragraph heading for the opening passage of the book of John is, "The Word became flesh." Throughout human history, words have been used to organize thoughts into plans, to focus our wandering minds on a purpose, and to inspire people toward that purpose. That's why many organizations craft these core values. Even though most people roll their eyes and think here they come with more of this nonsense. That's a cleaned up version of my thoughts every time I had to sit through one of those meetings. Here they come with more of this nonsense. But perhaps a set of personal core values for Christians isn't such a goofy idea. Faith first and always, to serve, not to be served, and love one another are the ones I've chosen. If you agree having core values for yourself might be a good idea, you can try those or come up with your own. Micah 6:8 says, "He has shown you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God." That's what our Father in heaven requires for us. Any Bible verse, hymn, poem, or set of core values that inspires you towards that purpose is useful, I think, if it keeps you on the path of righteousness and brings you closer to the Lord. If you feel yourself coming to the point where you want to be closer to the Lord, I offer you the invitation to come to the altar as we sing our closing hymn. Reflect on that, though, as we pray together. Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, people are gathered all over the world in churches you created this morning to worship you because you are worthy of all glory, honor, and praise. Hear our prayers, Lord, and bring us closer to you. Let your holy word and the teachings of your prophets, apostles, and especially your precious Son guide us and keep us on the path that leads to salvation with you. Mighty God, we pray for your help in recovering from the damage of Hurricane Helene. Comfort them in their loss and grief. Be with the relief workers. Keep them safe and focused on their vital work. Lord, we pray for peace in Israel. We pray that you touch the hearts of all those involved in the conflict and move them towards peace and resolving their differences and living in harmony together. Be with those who have suffered on all sides because of the bombing and the rockets and all the other attacks that are going on there. Lord, there are people all over the world in churches and in places where only you can see who are praying for your mercy and healing of those they love. Here in our church, Lord, we are so grateful and we praise you that Bonnie has been found without any kind of cancer in her scans. We pray that Sharon received the same results. We're grateful for your comforting and healing with Jackie and so many others, and that their treatments are going well. Watch over us and keep us safe, Lord. Deliver us from all the temptation that's going to come our way this week. Keep us safe from evil and danger, and bring us back again safely to worship you again in this house soon. In the name of your precious Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. the Lord make you increase and abound in love for one another and for all, as we do for you, so that he may be established your hearts blameless in holiness before our God and Father in the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful week. Be safe.